on this Wednesday. My name is Chris Curry, and I am the Communications and Marketing Manager here at the Georgia Cancer Center at Augusta University. I am joined today by Dr. Zach Klaassen. Dr. Zach Klaassen is a urologic oncologist here at the Georgia Cancer Center. And Dr. Klaassen, you're spending part of your Wednesday here talking about testicular cancer.
Yes.
All right. As you all may know, we've been sharing information this week. April is Testicular Cancer Awareness Month, and we want to take this time to ask Dr. Klaassen some questions. I got them right here. We're going to talk about testicular cancer. Also talk about screening, why it's important for parents to engage their teenage boys in their household about self-exams. First question, how common is testicular cancer in Georgia?
So in general, it's not common sort of when we think about prostate and lung cancer and colorectal and breast, but in a specific population, meaning men 15 to 35, 39 years old, it's one of the more common cancers, and that takes people by surprise, is that, you know, these are 20, 25, 30 year old guys that obviously aren't thinking about having cancer or being at risk for it, but that's the number one demographic. So in Georgia, it's very similar to the rest of the country. It's not common in itself, but certainly in the age group, it is common, relatively common.
Okay. Now we hear a lot about mammograms that screen women for breast cancer, but we don't necessarily always hear a lot about the need for self-exams for testicular cancer.
Yeah.
Can you talk to me about why screening for testicular cancer is so important, especially for men, teenage boys in that age group that you mentioned?
Yeah, so I think your mammogram example is very apt because obviously these are very personal parts of the body, and so it's a self-exam, obviously, and so just like a woman would do a breast exam once a month, we encourage men and boys in that age group to do the same thing with the testicle, basically just rolling the testicle between your fingers to feel if there's any firmness or lumps. And I say, you know, obviously you don't want to squeeze it too hard, but you want to make sure you feel it, and it should feel similar to the consistency of the inside of your thumb.
Yeah.
And if it feels abnormal, I mean, let somebody know. Sometimes it's adjacent to the testicle, there's structures there which may seem a little abnormal, and they're actually just normal, what they feel like. But really inside the testicle, lumps and bumps and firmness is something that we typically would want somebody to, you know, contact their primary care doctor and get that checked out, then obviously referrals over to us. So basically, we recommend that once a month in the shower. It's easy to do, and I think it's important to get that message out there. And I give the same lecture to our third year medical students every sort of cycle that they're on, and a lot of them, you know, will go tell their friends the same thing. So just getting the word out there that this is the demographic, this is the age group to do the self-exam.
So awareness, most important.
Absolutely.
All right. What can patients expect when they come to the Georgia Cancer Center after receiving a diagnosis of testicular cancer?
Sure. It's, as you can imagine, in this population, it's always a huge surprise. Obviously, like I said, guys in their 20s and 30s, this is not what they're expecting. It's very disruptive to their family life, to their school, to their work. And so we'll sit down, and a lot of the treatment and the discussions will be based on, you know, is it localized to the testicle? Is it spread to other parts of the body? Most commonly to the lymph nodes that sort of run in the back of the abdomen. And so sometimes it's taking out the testicle and just watching. Sometimes it gets more invasive, such as chemotherapy and surgery after that. So it's a long discussion based on which sort of category you fit into.
And of course, doing the screening, catching it early, much more important.
Yes, absolutely. So we know that there's been a stage migration in the right direction. What that means is that the cases that we're identifying are typically early, and so that means you still need to have the testicle removed and be surveyed with imaging and blood work, but you know, we've seen a stage migration to stage one versus what it may have been, you know, a few decades ago.
Okay. Now we talked a little about the treatments, the side of the surgery, the chemotherapy. Can you talk about some of the treatments, the side effects of the treatments, and talk a little bit about fertility? I know
you're
talking about that part of the body. Some men probably have questions about that. What can you tell them about that?
Yeah, there's a lot of talk about in the question you just asked. So I'll start with the surgery. So if we do surgery, we have to remove the testicle. That typically doesn't lead to fertility issues per se. But when we get into further treatment in terms of chemotherapy, surgery after chemotherapy, radiation, these are issues that can certainly affect fertility. And so any patient that we're seeing, typically when we've seen them already, or when we were seeing them as a new patient, they may have had the testicle removed by another physician that had been referred to us for subsequent, you know, therapy or consultation. But every patient gets a discussion about sperm banking, which is important, especially in these guys that either don't have kids or want kids, or have kids and want more kids. And so the subsequent therapy that happens after that can certainly affect the fertility. So the other thing is, we know from some of the studies that were done, you know, 30 years ago from Indiana, places that have treated testis cancer for years, where chemotherapy was really developed for it. There's now 30, 40 year data on these guys that were diagnosed in their 20s, now they're in their 60s. And so, you know, there's teasing things out. It looks like there's a little bit of an increased risk of cardiovascular disease, slightly increased risk of some of the leukemias and lymphomas. So these are things that we give them information up front, but it's not that we don't want to do the treatment. We still need to do what we have to do. We just have to be aware of these as we go forward. Because of chemotherapy and the dose that we can give these young guys who are healthy, you know, we're able to cure a lot of these patients, even with aggressive and high volume disease. But it does take big dose chemotherapy and sometimes surgery after the chemotherapy as well.
Okay. All right. Talk to me. So we've talked a little about fertility. Talk to me about how you try to help your patients and their families deal with the psychological side effects associated with the testicular cancer diagnosis.
And I know you and I have had these discussions offline, that testis cancer and these patients are a passion of mine. I did my training at a place where, in Toronto, where we saw the highest volume of testis cancer across the country, Canada. So taking stuff that they've developed there and bringing it down here and sort of establishing over the next years sort of a big referral center and sort of a center of excellence for getting these patients all under one roof, along with my colleagues in radiation oncology and Dr. Ramey and Dr. Parikh in medical oncology. So to answer your question, I think it takes a patient and a physician interaction that is, the physician really has to buy into these guys and what they're going through. And I think that's something that I think I do, and I think it helps with them going through the emotions of being angry and, you know, being in denial and worried about having kids and worried about side effects of treatment. And are they going to die? And these are all things that we talk about, either at the first visit, second visit. They've all got my email. Every testis cancer patient has my email, so they can contact me if they've got questions. And especially when it comes to the surveillance after them, I want them to buy into the program. So I get them all a calendar of what is coming each month for the next, what, 3, 5, 7 years, so they know that, all right, in 6 months we're going to do this, and 6 months after that we're going to do this. And I think that helps with their sort of survivorship plan, and certainly working with our colleagues in psycho-oncology have been fabulous as well. And so I offer all of them a referral for that if they want it at each visit. And so it depends. Everybody's a little bit different. Some people want to talk to somebody further. Some people are doing okay, and they don't. But these are all things that we talk about almost on a per-visit situation.
Okay. So screening, very important. Also options for fertility if that's a concern.
Yep.
All right. So that's all the questions that we have. Obviously, with as well as the COVID-19, the coronavirus, if you have any questions for Dr. Klaassen, as he said, this is a passionate area of his. So please ask those questions. We want to get those answers. We want to get that awareness. And we'll be sharing more information throughout the rest of the week. Thank you for joining us.
My pleasure. Thanks.